Hey people, I'm Lisa Ling, and you're watching 411 at Hudson County School of Technology at Channel 1 Flagship School.
And welcome to 411's Halloween special.
Today during our spooky Halloween special, we will have a commentary on Mischief Night with Crystal, sports news with Amy, question of the week with Frank and Mo,
along with Natalie's punk piece and the 411 pop quiz. So stay tuned for our Hair Raising show. And now let's go to Natalie and Angela for the school news.
Thanks, Crystal. On Sunday, October 17th, several students from High Tech's Performing Arts Department participated in Ballet Folklorio, a dance event whose purpose was to raise money for the victims of Hurricane George. Our 401 cameras were on the scene to give you a glimpse of the show. On Wednesday, October 14th, the junior class elected their new student council members to represent them. The winners were Secretary Steven Diaz, Treasurer Danielle Tamayo, Vice President Fatima Torres, and President Elizabeth Coe. Congratulations to all of you.
Also, the sophomores elected the representatives on October 21st. The winners from this election were Secretary Vicky Osorio, Treasurer Monsignor Likes, Vice President Sandra Guerra, and President Chris Bell. Once again, we here at 411 would like to extend our congratulations to these newly elected officials.
And finally, the freshman class will be voting for their student government representatives later today. Good luck to all the students running in the election.
411 would like to congratulate the members of this year's Quiz Bowl team. They are Anthony Sampson, Fred Redona, Stephanie Warnick, Robert Goulding, Rajesh Malakane, and an alternate Robert Negron.
We here at 411 would also like to congratulate the elected BICA officials, who are Joanne Kennedy, Bernadette Castillo, Laura Sol Fernandez, Jasenia Fernandez, Nicole Zelinski, and Danny Aiba. On October 23rd, these officials attended the BICA Leadership Conference, where they were all introduced to other elected officials from vocational schools throughout the state.
Jose Ferrer, Raymond Castro, Jose Lopez, and Bibi Ali will all be attending an award ceremony later on today at Mill Creek Mall. The students were among four of nine winners out of 95 entries to place in the contest. The winners will be receiving prizes that range from $100 to $1,500 for their artwork. Also, the students will be bestowed with the honor of seeing their artwork become a permanent part of the new decor for the mall's food court.
Reminder for the members of the National Honor Society, the next meeting will be held on Wednesday, November 4th in Ms. Dekoff's room.
Also, the Key Club's next meeting will be on either the 4th or the 5th of November. Check with Ms. Kahn for the official date.
The Key Club has submitted three proposals to Ms. Moncado, and depending on approval, they will occur on the following dates. The first proposal is a November 23rd movie showing in the ITV Center. The film playing will be Armageddon, and the money raised will be donated to the homeless. Another proposal is a food drive whose deadline will be on the 20th of November. All the food must be brought to Ms. Camp's room, and it will be donated to St. Lucie's Soup Kitchen, located in Jersey City. The final proposal will be a raffle on the 25th for a $30 gift certificate for Sam Goody. To get raffle tickets, you must bring in food products in return. For more information on any of these proposals, see Ms. Camp.
High Tech High School will now have a monthly newspaper produced by Mr. Jeremias in his journalism class. The first edition should be out by today.
Finally, any student wishing to provide candid pictures for this year's yearbook should see Mrs. Lindsley in room 127 or give it to any senior. That's all for school news. Now let's go to Amy with the 411 sports news.
Thanks.
Thanks, Natalie. The girls' tennis season has come to an end. Their record going into the final game yesterday was 10-6. Now let's go to an interview with their coach to get a feel of how the season went.
Here with Beth Polito, the girls' tennis team coach. Ms. Polito, could you mention the starting lineup of the tennis team?
Sure. At first singles, we have Danielle Tamayo. Second singles, Bernadette Castillo. Third singles, Katrina Austria. First doubles, we have Lorisol Fernandez and Clarice Reyes. And second doubles, we have Jenny Strobel and Kara Kaminsky.
How's the girls' tennis season going so far, in your opinion?
Well, we're almost done with it, and it's going great so far. Right now we're 10-7. We lost a couple of tough matches to Holy Family twice, North Bergen twice, who happened to be first and second in the county. We lost a couple other matches that I thought we should have won. For instance, we lost to Bayonne once after beating them the first time around, and we lost to Kearney once as well after beating them the first time around. So those were tough losses.
Could you name any wins that were especially satisfying?
Well, every win is satisfying, but particularly beating Academic was, since they're kind of a rival of ours. So we beat them yesterday 3-2, and that was pretty exciting.
Have the girls fulfilled all your expectations for them this year?
Oh, definitely. We actually went to the States this year. Unfortunately, we lost in the first round, but it was an honor to be eligible to go to the States.
What do you expect from the girls' tennis team in the future?
I expect to beat those top schools in the county. Like I said, Holy Family, North Bergen, and Kearney.
Thank you, Ms. Polito. This has been Amy for the 411 Sports News.
The intramural flag football tournament has also come to a close. The Super Bowl, held on Wednesday, October 21st, was a rematch of last year's finalists. In the end, the Ebbies came out on top with an 8-5 win over the Mad Bombers. Let's see some highlights from the tournament. As I mentioned last time, this 411 Sports segment will be featuring a special guest commentary on the magical 1998 New York Yankees, written by Paul Bukowski. Along with this, you'll be seeing some scenes of the postseason, the ticker tape parade, and also the student and faculty members of High Tech showing off their Yankee pride. Take a look.
When they write the story of the 1998 New York Yankees, they may write the story of the perfect team with a perfect manager. They may write the story of David Wells, who will forever live in our hearts with his perfect game. Do not be surprised if they mention Derek Jeter, the first shortstop in Yankees history to have more than 16 home runs and the first since Phil Rizzuto to have 200 hits, or maybe center fielder Bernie Williams and his batting title. Last, but definitely not least, will be the 114 regular season victories. No team in the history of the American League had more. However, one thing is for sure when they write the story of the 1998 New York Yankees. They'll write a story about the heart and soul of a champion. It was a season of high expectations that began on a very low note. The Yankees started the year 0-3. On the way to their first victory, the Yankees lost their star closer Mariano Rivera to an injury. He would eventually be shut down for the next 2 weeks. But, as all of you know, the Yankees went on a tear after the ominous start and never looked back. There were many great games, including complete games, game-winning home runs, and mind-blowing comebacks, which could be debated as the defining moments of the season. However, as far as I'm concerned, the turning point of the season came very early. It occurred in a dreaded place named the Kingdom. The Yankees were clinging onto a 4-3 lead in the ninth for their third win when Mariano Rivera's replacement, left-hander Mike Stanton, did the improbable. He induced a game-ending double play ball off the bat of Yankee killer Edgar Martinez. This would be the second of 8 straight wins for the Bombers, and it would take over 2 months before they lost their next series. The next magical moment in the season requires no description, just a date, May 17th, 1998. An achievement so spectacular that only 13 men in baseball's lush history accomplished this feat. In a way, it is very ironic that David Wells, the most unexpected pitcher to pitch a perfect game, will forever be remembered and recorded next to the names he has studied and admired all his life. Now there is just one more game that stands out in my mind. Funny enough, it wasn't even a win. In the first game of a series with their intense rivals, the Red Sox, the Yankees were down 8-0 facing Pedro Martinez on the mound. The Yanks were able to close the gap to 8-7, and although their comeback fell short, they sent this message to the Red Sox and the rest of baseball. There is no quitting in the New York Yankees. It was a magical regular season, and what else would be better to cap it off with than a World Series championship? The Bronx Bombers blew through the Texas Rangers in the division series, sweeping them in 3 straight games. Their next opponent, the Cleveland Indians, would prove to be their most challenging competition in the playoffs. When down 1-2 in the ALCS, the Yanks hushed all the naysayers and displayed the determination of a true champion by going on a stretch of 7 straight postseason wins, including a World Series sweep of the San Diego Padres. This dominating playoff performance would deserve nothing less than a ruckus ticker tape parade down the Canyon of Heroes. With this came a closure to the season of arguably the best team in the history of baseball, a fitting title for the men in navy blue pinstripes and interlocking NYs.
That's all for sports news. Now here's Aoife Mendehardy with World Events.
Thanks, Amy. Hi there, and welcome to World and National News again.
Yes, today we'll be discussing the elections in Washington.
My word, how exciting.
And how.
We'll review some footage for some of you people who don't know exactly what's going on.
From a political impact standpoint, wouldn't it be better for you if he stays in office as a conservative than to have a President Gore, who certainly doesn't have a moral taint about sexual affairs about him, suddenly taken over?
Well, what a great question there. You know what my response is? I go back to this whole idea that there's something bigger out there than Bill Clinton, and that is the issue of right and wrong. If this man were a Republican, I would be here tonight saying the exact same thing.
In Washington recently, CNN and USA Today made a recent Gallup poll concerning the impeachment trial.
Most Americans remained opposed to the impeachment proceedings of President Clinton. About 62% of all Americans, and also 55% of likely voters, said they are opposed to the impeachment.
Do you approve or disapprove of the way Mr. William Clinton is handling his job as president? That was one of the many questions asked in the CNN and USA Today's Gallup poll. The results came about to be that 65% of Americans approve of his work, and 63% during the month of October 6th to the 7th.
If you want more information on the polls, visit the CNN's website at www.cnn.com. And let's go to Crystal with her Halloween commentary.
As you all know, tonight is Mischief Night, or as they say in Detroit, Devil's Night. But how exactly did this night originate? The night before All Hallows' Eve was the night when Llewellyn, a troublemaking fairy, would hide out to snatch the souls of unexpected prey and cause mischief, hence the name Mischief Night. Nowadays, although no known fairies roam our grounds, it became a tradition that children embraced, roaming around with shaving cream and eggs causing havoc. Although it sounds harmless, throughout the years, numerous accounts of violence and vandalism have occurred during this night, bringing a bad name to an innocent evening of fun. In extreme cases, such as Detroit, this night has become the night of flames, in which over 40 houses are torched to the ground. This is an unfortunate distortion of a traditional prank.
So remember that mischief night is supposed to be innocent fun. So if you're going to indulge, be courteous to others. If you're not going to participate, be very, very careful.
Hey, this is Natalie presenting the first of hopefully many more punk rock show segments. Today we'll be viewing scenes from the Les and Jake show on October 15th in Hunka Bunka Ballroom in Sayreville. These are some of the things you missed.
Good. I felt that it was a little weak at the beginning, little baby mosh pits until the end, but I wasn't in the last mosh pit. The mosh pit was good, I got kicked in the face.
Best time I've seen him yet.
And now let's go to some footage from the segment Pop Quiz to see how smart high-techers really are.
I'm here with Jalo. Jalo, do you know who is your class president?
Nah, not really.
Who's your class president?
Don't care.
That's Julio. Julio Cesar Sesti. Yeah.
Okay, Julio. MJ?
Me? I don't know.
Who's the vice president of the United States?
I don't know. I don't know nothing.
Who's the vice president of the United States?
I don't know.
Who's the guy? Do you know who the vice president of the United States is?
Yeah.
Do you know what Janet Reno's job is?
The same as Monica's? I don't know. What was it?
I'm not too sure. I don't know.
Who's Janet Reno?
I don't know. I know Janet Jackson's job.
Secretary. I don't know.
Who's Janet Reno?
I don't know. Secretary of Defense. Defense? Secretary of Defense?
She's that, like, scary big lady that's on the TV. I don't know exactly what she does.
I don't know anything.
At what age can you become president?
21? 18?
50?
I think 30? I don't know.
24. Now?
40. 18? 21? I'd love to drink.
32? I don't know.
Oh, who was Newt Gingrich? I don't know. I got a few newts in my tank. You know, those little lizards.
Who was Newt Gingrich? I don't know.
What's his job?
I don't know. Damn. I don't know.
All right. No clue.
I have no idea.
Some fat guy.
Some dude. I don't know.
A singer.
That guy who, like, says a lot of stuff. He's the representative for the House of Representatives.
Well, he's the gray guy, right? The one with the gray hair. He's big.
A man?
What president is on a $50 bill?
I don't know. I'm not that rich, so.
Kennedy?
Theodore Roosevelt? Hamilton.
I don't know. If I had $50, I would tell you.
Abraham Lincoln.
Jefferson.
All right, who's on the $50 bill?
I've never seen. I can't afford a $50 bill. I wouldn't know.
I'm not rich. Oh, no. Frankly.
Dude, a 50? Yeah, man. He's my favorite.
Hey, how you doing? I'm Frank.
And I'm Mo. The Dark Crusader meets the Man of Steel.
See what people had to say about that.
Take a look.
This is Mo for 401's Question of the Week. I'm here with
Josh.
And the question of the week is, who do you think would win in a staring contest, Batman or Superman?
Superman.
And why is that?
Because Batman's just some guy in a suit, and Superman's got all these special powers.
Oh. And one more thing, who do you think Pikachu is?
Do you know who he is?
Yes, I do.
Well, I don't.
I'm here with?
Michael.
All right, the question is, very serious now, who will win in a staring contest, Batman or Superman?
Batman.
Why is that?
Because I guess, like, Superman would just fly away or something.
Why would Superman fly away?
Just like Batman's more serious.
Alright, very good. Who's Pikachu?
That guy from, like, Pokemon or something?
Who do you think will win in a staring contest, Batman or Superman?
I think Superman.
And why is that?
Because he's the man.
Oh. And another one is, who is Pikachu?
Pikachu?
Yeah.
Pikachu?
Pikachu.
Because, I don't know.
I think Superman, because Superman is superhuman and Batman is a regular person. That's it.
And who's Pikachu?
What?
Who's Pikachu?
What?
Who's Pikachu?
Who's that?
I'm asking you.
Pikachu? Pikachu?
Pikachu. Is if Superman and Batman were to have a staring contest, who would win?
Superman.
And one more thing, who's Pikachu?
Some new cartoon in the morning.
How you doing? I'm Frank. I'm here for the question of the week. I'm here with
MJ.
Jesse.
I'm gonna ask him the question of the week. This week's question is, who do you think will win in a staring contest? Either Batman or Superman?
Superman.
Batman.
Why?
Superman has superpowers. Batman's a human. Batman will play it off.
Alright, one more thing. Alright, who's Pikachu?
Some show that you always talk about.
Alright.
What?
Who's Pikachu?
Who's what?
Who's Pikachu?
Pikachu.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And the question of the week is, if Batman and Superman were to have a staring contest, who would win?
Batman.
And why is that?
Because he's the man.
And one more thing, who's Pikachu?
Huh?
Pikachu.
What?
Pikachu.
I have no idea.
Okay. This is more for 401 question of the week. Back to you guys.
Thank you for watching 401's Halloween special. Remember, tonight is mischief night, so be careful and have fun. Happy Halloween.
Bela became a wolf, and you killed him. A werewolf can be killed only with a silver bullet, or a silver knife, or a stick with a silver handle.
You're insane. I tell you, I killed a wolf, a plain, ordinary wolf.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an eerie sight. For my monster from his lab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.